Hello and welcome back. You're watching Parry This. Today we will be talking about a topic related to Kingdom Come Deliverance. That topic is the widely requested Hussite Wars. Now mind you, there's a lot to go over, so this will likely be only the first in probably at least two videos covering this topic. So since there is so much to cover, let's dive on in and start learning about the Hussite Wars, otherwise known as the Bohemian Wars. The Hussite Wars, also called the Bohemian Wars, involved the military actions against and amongst the followers of Jan Hus in Bohemia in the period from 1420 to 1434. If you want to know more about Jan Hus, I actually did a whole video about him a while back, and it explains everything you would ever need to know about him. The Hussite Wars were arguably the first European war in which handheld gunpowder weapons, such as muskets, made a decisive contribution. The Hussite warriors were basically infantry, and their many defeats of larger armies with heavily armored knights helped effect the infantry revolution. In the end, it was an inconclusive war. Some Hussites embraced pacifism and were not involved in the wars, which they denounced. These Hussites taught that Christians should separate themselves from the state and refuse to fight even for secular rulers, since Christians must always practice love. Critics of religion point to the Hussite Wars and to other conflicts that appear to have been religiously motivated to claim that religion is a negative aspect of human life, often the cause of violence, division, and oppression. Religious people, they argue, assert exclusive truth claims and try to compel others to conform to their beliefs. Throughout history, some people of faith have engaged in armed struggle. However, the Hussites merely wanted the freedom to practice what they believed. It was the state that restricted this. The Hussites, too, were not purely motivated by religion. Their movement was closely linked with the Czech people's desire to assert their national identity and independence. The Hussite movement assumed a revolutionary character as soon as the news of the execution of the proto-Protestant reformer Jan Hus by order of the Council of Constance on July 6, 1415, reached Prague. The knights and nobles of Bohemia and Moravia, who were in favor of church reform, sent a protest to the Council of Constance on September 2, 1415, known as the Protestato Bohemorum, which condemned the execution of Hus in the strongest language. The attitude of Sigismund, Holy Roman Emperor, who sent threatening letters to Bohemia declaring that he would shortly drown all Wycliffeites and Hussites, greatly incensed the people. Trouble broke out in various parts of Bohemia, and drove many Catholic priests from their parishes. Almost from the first, the Hussites divided into two groups, though many minor divisions also developed amongst them. Shortly before his death, Hus had accepted a doctrine preached during his absence by his followers at Prague, namely that of Utraquism, or the obligation of the faithful to receive communion in both kinds, bread and wine. This doctrine became the watchword of the moderate Hussites known as the Utraquists, or Calixtine, from the Latin calyx, or the chalice, which the more extreme Hussites soon became known as the Taborites, named after the city of Tabor that became their center, or Orphans, a name they adopted after the death of their beloved leader and general, Jan Žižka. The Utraquists hoped to be reconciled with Rome. The Taborites had no such expectation. Later, the Unitas Fratrum emerged, attracting members from both, but embraced pacifism, becoming a peace church. Under the influence of his brother Sigismund, King Wenceslaus IV of Bohemia endeavored to stem the Hussite movement. He did so for political reasons. His ambition to be crowned as emperor meant that his own kingdom had to be Catholic. Initially, he had protected Hus, but later changed policy. A certain number of Hussites led by Nicholas of Hus, no relation of Jan Hus, though of the same town, left Prague. They held meetings in various parts of Bohemia, particularly Sezimovo Usti, near the spot where the town of Tabor was founded soon after. At these meetings, they strongly denounced Sigismund. Their supporters prepared for war. The wars were also a protest against the German aristocracy, the power of the monarchy and of the church, an expression of Czech national identity. Although many prominent Hussites had now left Prague, troubles continued. On July 30th, 1419, when a Hussite procession headed by the priest Jan Zelewski marched through the streets of Prague, anti-Hussites threw stones at the Hussites from the windows of the town hall of the New Town. The people headed by Jan Žižka threw the burgomaster and several town councillors who had instigated this outrage from the windows. This event would become known as the First Defenestration of Prague. The crowd, of course, killed them immediately. King Wenceslaus died of natural causes a few days later on August 16, 1419. The king's death resulted in renewed unrest in Prague and in many other areas of Bohemia. Many Catholics, mostly Germans, for they had almost all remained faithful to the papal cause, suffered expulsion from the Bohemian cities. In Prague, in November 1419, severe fighting took place between the Hussites and the mercenaries, whom Queen Sophia, the widow of Wenceslaus and regent after the death of her husband, had hurriedly collected. After a considerable part of the city had been destroyed, the parties declared a truce on November 13th. The nobles, though favorable to the Hussite cause, supported the regent and promised to act as mediators with Sigismund, while the citizens of Prague consented to restore to the royal forces the castle of Wieserode, which had fallen into their hands. Žižka, who disapproved of this compromise, left Prague and retired to Pilsen. Unable to defend himself there, he marched to southern Bohemia, and after defeating the Catholics at the Battle of Sudomer on March 25, 1420, in the first pitched battle of the Hussite Wars, he arrived at Usti, one of the earliest meeting places of the Hussites. Not considering its situation sufficiently strong, he moved to the neighboring new settlement of the Hussites, called by the biblical name of Tabor. Tabor soon became the center of the Taborites, who differed from the Utraquists by recognizing only two sacraments, baptism and communion, and by rejecting most of the ceremony of the Roman Catholic Church. The ecclesiastical organization of Tabor had a somewhat puritanical character, and the government was established on a thoroughly democratic basis. Four captains of the people were elected, one of whom was Žižka, and a very strictly military discipline was then instituted. Now let's talk a little bit about those interesting Hussite war tactics, primarily the Wagenburg tactics. Depending on the terrain, Hussites prepared carts for the battle, forming them into squares or circles. The carts were joined wheel to wheel by chains and positioned aslant, with their corners attached to each other, so that horses could be harnessed to them quickly if necessary. In front of this wall of carts was a ditch that was dug by camp followers. The crew of each cart consisted of 16 to 22 soldiers, 4 to 8 crossbowmen, 2 handgunners, and 6 to 8 soldiers equipped with pikes or flails, and then of course 2 shield carriers and 2 drivers for the wagons. The Hussites' battle strategy consisted of 2 stages, the first one defensive, and the second an offensive counterattack. In the first stage, the army placed the carts near the enemy army and by means of artillery fire provoked the enemy into battle. The artillery would usually inflict heavy casualties at close range. In order to avoid more losses, the enemy knights finally attacked. Then, the infantry hidden behind the carts used firearms and crossbows to ward off the attack, weakening the enemy. The shooters aimed first at the horses, depriving the cavalry of its main advantage. Many of the knights died as their horses were shot and then they fell. As soon as the enemy's morale was sufficiently lowered, the second stage, an offensive counterattack, began. The infantry and the cavalry burst out from behind the carts, striking violently at the enemy, mostly from the flanks. While fighting on the flanks and being shelled from the carts, the enemy was not able to put up much resistance. They were forced to withdraw, leaving behind dismounted knights in heavy armor who were unable to escape the battlefield. The enemy armies suffered heavy losses, and the Hussites soon had the reputation of not taking captives. After the death of his childless brother, Wenceslaus, Sigismund had acquired a claim on the Bohemian crown, though it was then and remained till much later in question whether Bohemia was a hereditary or an elective monarchy. A firm adherent of the Church of Rome, Sigismund was successful in obtaining aid from Pope Martin V, who issued a bill on the 17th of March 1420, which proclaimed a crusade, quote, "for the destruction of the Wycliffites, Hussites, and all other heretics in Bohemia." Unquote. Sigismund and many German princes arrived before Prague on the 30th of June, at the head of a vast army of crusaders from all parts of Europe, largely consisting of adventurers attracted by the hope of pillage. They immediately began a siege of the city, which was, however, soon to be abandoned. Negotiations took place for a settlement of the religious differences. The United Hussites formulated their demands in a statement known as the Four Articles of Prague. This document, the most important of the Hussite period, ran in the wording of the contemporary chronicler Lawrence of Brzozowa as follows. Number 1. The word of God shall be preached and made known in the kingdom of Bohemia freely and in an orderly manner by the priests of the Lord. Number 2. The sacrament of the Most Holy Eucharist shall be freely administered in two kinds, that is, bread and wine, to all the faithful in Christ who are not precluded by mortal sin, according to the word and disposition of our Savior. Number 3. The secular power over riches and worldly goods which the clergy possesses in contradiction to Christ's precept, to the prejudice of its own office and to the detriment of the secular arm, shall be taken and withdrawn from it, and the clergy itself shall be brought back to the evangelical rule and an apostolic life, such as that which Christ and his apostles led. Finally, number 4, all mortal sins, and in particular all public and other disorders, which are contrary to God's law, shall, in every rank of life, be duly and judiciously prohibited, and destroyed by those whose office it is. These articles, which contain the essence of the Hussite doctrine, were rejected by Sigismund, mainly through the influence of papal legates, who considered them prejudicial to the authority of the Roman See. Hostilities therefore continued. Though Sigismund had retired from Prague, the castles of Vyšehrad and Hradčany remained in possession of his troops. The citizens of Prague laid siege to Vyšehrad, and towards the end of October 1420, the garrison was on the point of capitulating through famine. Sigismund attempted to relieve the fortress, but was decisively defeated by the Hussites on the 1st of November near the village of Pankrak. The castles of Vyšehrad and Hradčany now capitulated, and shortly after this, all of Bohemia fell into the hands of the Hussites. So that was the first anti-Hussite crusade, so let's quick talk about the second anti-Hussite crusade. Internal strife prevented the followers of Hus from fully capitalizing on their victory. At Prague, a demagogue, the priest Jan Zalewski, for a time obtained almost unlimited authority over the lower classes of the townsmen, and at Tabor, a religious communistic movement, the Adamites, were sternly suppressed by Žižka. Shortly after, a new crusade against the Hussites was undertaken. A large German army entered Bohemia and in August 1421 laid siege to the town of Zatek. After an unsuccessful attempt of storming the city, the crusaders retreated somewhat ingloriously on hearing that the Hussite troops were approaching. Sigismund only arrived in Bohemia at the end of the year 1421. He took possession of the town of Kutná Hora, but was decisively defeated by Jan Žižka at the Battle of Nemecký Brod on January 6th, 1422. Well, that actually brings us to the end of part one of what we're going to talk about today. Next time, we will pick it up with the next logical topic for the Hussite Wars, which will be the Hussite Civil War. Just so you know, it only gets messier from here, so make sure you subscribe so you don't miss it. In any case, thanks for watching, and have a nice day, and I'll see you next time.